Well, this is a very special roundtable. We'll get to Professor Corey Brettschneider in a second, Doctor. One of the most renowned dentists in America.
Corey's a big deal. I'm very happy to be here.
But let me introduce Mark Thompson, because it's both of you are geniuses, and you're Renaissance men, and you have this great capacity to learn things very easily, and I'm impressed by your brain power. Mark Thompson is a meteorologist. You are a scientist.
Well, small s on scientist, David. Let me just say I am a devotee of this podcast, and I'm.
Let me introduce you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Yeah,
you're a meteorologist.
Tell me when I can start talking.
You can predict the weather
with some questionable accuracy, but yes.
And you have been a weatherman on television in L.A. and San Francisco since 1981.
Yeah, it's true.
You host a show on KFI.
That's right.
70,000 watts.
I don't know how many watts, but it's the most listened to talk station in America.
You're also a brilliant voiceover artist.
Yes, I exude brilliance in everything I do, David.
You're the voice of this show.
I am the voice of this show, that's correct.
Yes.
And I receive the same bloated fee that that I'm getting for being here today, which is nothing.
Corey,
you get paid?
It's favorite nations.
He is.
And it's UNESCO. You have to be a member of UNESCO to be part of my favorite nations. So, yes.
But it's exciting.
And you're a voiceover.
To be here, I mean.
You have been in movies.
I have.
You've played reporters on Air Force One.
Yep.
And An American President.
Yep.
How many movies have you been in?
I don't know, David.
Independence Day.
Gosh, when I attended the Mark Thompson Film Festival a few years ago, it was hours of just my best stuff. And I did Q&A. I don't know if you take that out. Maybe it's like an hour and a half.
You are one of the great impressionists. When we did sketches on this show in L.A.,
wow.
You could do anybody.
Oh, thank you, David. We had a lot of fun. And
you're a genius. You really are a genius.
Well, David, I can't argue with that label.
A mathematician?
If I can figure out anything, I can figure out the tip. For like the Uber tips,
what's
I figure
a tip?
Out without the little without the little app. Hey,
and not only yep. that, you sold The Bachelor.
Yep, I did.
I first
was the first one to pitch The Bachelor. My partner Mike Fleiss came up with the idea at the time.
And you have been one of the chief promulgators
yes.
of reality television.
Well, in the early stages, now
the voice of American Idol.
The voice of American Idol. It's true. Yeah, thank you. I was very uncomfortable with all these accolades, and now I'm oddly becoming more comfortable.
You are
relaxing.
Yeah, keep going. Yeah.
You are pretty amazing.
I'd love it if you'd include my podcast, which I also have, which is called The Edge with Mark Thompson. And it's not quite as long as your podcast. Yours is, yours will come in. By the way, I listen to it all, which is crazy. I'm looking. I listen to David's podcast. And
by the way, this is still last week's podcast.
Exactly.
That's how long last week's.
You're like, it's 4 hours and 20 minutes. I can't believe I'm listening. This is one episode. Yeah. So I doubt that people who listen to this show will be able to listen to mine because their week is filled up listening to yours. But I have a podcast called The Edge with Mark Thompson.
And it's fantastic, and I've been
Thank
on
you.
It. And
yeah, you are great, and Corey will be on it as well.
So. Corey's going to be on it. You're going to poach right. Corey. Corey Brettschneider.
Wow.
Let's go over you. You have a undergraduate degree from Pomona. Let me see if I get this right.
Okay.
You have a master's in philosophy from Cambridge.
Wow.
Correct? You have a law degree from Stanford.
Yeah.
Wow.
Wait. And a PhD in political science from Princeton.
Holy shiite.
And he teaches at Brown University. And 2 weeks ago, he had lunch with Anthony Kennedy.
Jeez.
The justice.
Was it just the two of you, or how many people were at the lunch?
Yeah, it was pretty big. It was like, big group, about 30.
You can edit that part out.
I can tell. It's not as impressive.
And
I can't tell you what he ate, though.
But, and last week, you interviewed Preet Bharara. Did I get the last name right?
Yeah, actually, just 2 days ago.
2 days ago at Brown,
yep.
You did a one-on-one.
We did.
Tell everybody who Preet Bharara is. He's a big deal.
He was the U.S. attorney for the Southern District of New York and now has his own podcast, a
but
competitor.
He was removed by...
And he was fired by Donald Trump after several phone calls, an important one at the end, which Bahara refused to return. And one theory is that that's the reason why he was fired, because he didn't want to be in a position of being unduly influenced. But thank you from the pivot from all the degrees and that intro.
Well, you are a distinguished guy, and you're a published author.
Yes.
When the State Speaks. And your work, can we talk about your new book?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That'd be good.
My mother isn't getting any younger.
And that's what it's called?
No, but Corey Corey has decided to put my name on it instead.
It's called The David Feldman Show, and then it friends.
What is the name of your book? Can you talk about your new book?
Yeah, it's coming out. Look for it. It'll be out in September, but you'll be able to order it sooner. It's called The Oath and the Office, and the subtitle is A Guide to the Constitution for Future Presidents. And the idea is it's everything that you need to know about the Constitution if you want to hold the highest office in the land. So take a look.
Yeah.
And something that has some relevance.
The other thing is people are constantly playing the Constitution card in conversations, yet most of us know very little about the Constitution, aside from the card that we're playing in that argument that we're in.
Yeah. Most people know something a little more than the person who's got the highest office in the land right
now. That is certainly true. That is certainly true.
So I'll give them that credit. But yeah, this is trying to up the level of the game. It's written in a way that's accessible. It's not an academic book. It's got a lot of stories in it, some of which are getting edited out, but some of which will be in there. And it's really something that's meant to both be engaging, but also to really let people know what it requires to hold this office. It's a constitutionally created office. And it's also, and this is the important point, limited by the Constitution. It's not a license to do anything. It's a kind of trust that's instilled in the executive branch and in the president in particular. And if you violate it, part of the point of the book is there's something that the rest of us can do about it. So there's a set of expectations that come with taking the oath to solemnly swear to uphold and defend the Constitution. And if you fail as a future president to do it, the Congress, the 25th Amendment, the role of the states, there are things to do to stop you. So it's about what's expected and the Constitution. I mean, one of the things it begins with is the story of George Washington. In his second inaugural address, he stands up there and he says, "I just took the oath of office. It's a promise to uphold the Constitution. And if I fail to do it," it's a very short address, but he says, "if I fail to do it, subject me to constitutional punishment." So it's trying to revive that awesome idea of George Washington, that this is a office that comes with an enormous amount of duty, a duty to respect rights, the Bill of Rights, to not just not violate them as this president has, but to uphold them. And it's also about the threat that the people can take that back from you if you fail to comply with it.
Isn't the Constitution, don't you think the Constitution, I'm asking, is being used a bit or segueing into use the same way the Bible is used? And by that I mean, you know, they swing it around and refer to it a lot. But the body, which you were talking about, is particularly in regards to the 25th Amendment or whatever, a charge with perhaps enforcing the enforcer, the president, is just kind of no longer feels bound by the Constitution or used as the Constitution in the way that they want.
Yeah. I mean, I think that people in power often will throw words around, and the president has a team of lawyers, initially a pretty bad group of lawyers, thankfully. That's one of the reasons why we've been able to stop them on issues like the travel ban, issues like sanctuary cities, increasingly better. And I think you can use the language of the Constitution in an abusive way, or you could use it in a way that's more honest. And this is a book about trying to come down from the abusive way, I guess, of using the Constitution.
And Harvey Weinstein has optioned the book, as I understand it.
Yeah, I think, you know, I've turned down Harvey's deal. I'm not happy with what he's been up to. And, you know, I've got my limits.
Absolute power. That's an example of no checks and balances. The dangers.
It is, yeah. It's a bully, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, and, you know, there are visions of the presidency, unfortunately, that are very different than Washington's. And it's the idea, I mean, Woodrow Wilson, I think, is partly responsible. The idea of the president as a leader who has direct authority to do basically whatever he or she wants, because they've been elected by all of the people. And Wilson didn't quite have that idea. What I just said, I think, goes further than what Wilson said. But if you look at Trump, you know, I think that's his very limited understanding of the presidency. He talks all the time about being elected, and he thinks that election is licensed to do anything. And that's wrong. That's not what the office is about.
Speaking to Mark's comparing the Constitution to the Bible, that's brilliant observation.
Yeah.
Because you do find these strict textualists, is that what they're called?
Yeah.
Who, like Scalia, who reads the Constitution the same way he reads the Bible, I would assume.
Yeah.
With his eyes closed because he's dead. And when they were writing the Constitution, you said that George W. Washington...
Is that his middle name?
No.
G.W. Washington. G.W. Bridge.
When the father of our country, who, by the way, was sterile. Did you know that?
I did not.
He could not have kids.
And from what?
From smallpox.
Is that right?
Yeah. So the father of our country is sterile.
Where is that documented?
I make stuff up.
I see.
Come on, you guys. What do you guys know? It's not like a bunch of comics. You don't know anything. So... when they were writing, and you said in the second inaugural address, he spoke of the Constitution.
Mm-hmm.
Did they know they were writing something like a Bible?
I don't think they intended it to be read that way at all. I mean, they were really, you know, trained in law, and they believed in, I think the fundamental idea was to get away from a kind of faith-based approach. And that's true in a couple of ways.
No, what I mean is... did they know that the Constitution was really important?
Oh, yeah. Oh, they talked about it. And I mean, that's why...
this was going to be the blueprint?
Absolutely. Oh, I think in a way that's much more profound. And even though it is right to say that people talk about the Constitution in this sort of abstract way, I think for what Washington is saying, I mean, it's really all he says. It's only a few sentences long. And what he's saying is, like, this is all that matters, is this oath I just took and the document that... you know, he had been there when it was written. That's part of it. So he sat in front of the room. He didn't say much, but he sat in front of the room while they were writing it. And they took it very seriously because, and this gets back to what I started to say, they saw it as the fundamental law of the land. And it was the thing that was going to define what they did. And most importantly, they were, you know, pissed off about monarchy. They did not like George III. They saw the danger in it. And they saw this document as the way to stop it. Now, it wasn't just about understanding the document the way you would the Bible or a fundamentalist would understand it. I don't think they would read it in this sort of narrow or semantic or dictionary-based way, which is really how Scalia thought we should read it. They thought it was a kind of set of laws and also a philosophy of limited government and not basically, you know, falling prey to kingly power and domination. I mean, that was really their worry.
Yeah, but it's been extended now, of course. Even the last part of what you're talking about has been extended to a sort of bludgeon healthcare system, to, you know, anything that, we got to get government, we've got to get authoritarian power, out of our daily life. I mean, so it's used to reform tax code. It's used to, as I say, attack healthcare system. But oddly, it's then used... to affect reproductive rights and a bunch of other things that you seem inconsistent with that. You want the government out, but you want to outlaw this and enforce that. And so it seems as though it's arbitrarily, I guess.
Well, I think you need to, you know, we need to just engage in a conversation about the kind of liberty that's protected. And you're absolutely right. It has been used in the past. I mean, there was a long, very long period of history before the New Deal that basically ended with Roosevelt, where the court would just strike down any social welfare protection. So maximum hours legislation and a case called Lochner about striking down laws saying that there are basically protections for workers' rights and maximum hours legislation, even child labor at one point. All of those things were struck down by the court in the early 20th century. Now, one thing to say, which people did say around the time of Roosevelt and after, is, you know what, this whole Constitution thing is awful because it's just protecting.
Okay, so slow down.
But I think that's not the way
hold that
see
thought
it.
For one second.
Yeah.
So Roosevelt was president in the 30s.
Yeah.
And he tried to pack the Supreme Court
to
push through the New Deal legislation. Mm. You're saying that before the 30s, before Roosevelt, the Supreme Court was striking down progressive legislation Why? How were they? What precedent? How were they justifying that?
They had a doctrine which is now used to defend, I think, important rights like privacy and abortion rights that they called substantive due process. That was the name that got used for it. And they drew out of the due process clause, which says basically you can't revoke liberty, life, liberty, or property without due process.
Define due process. We hear that all the time. Mm-hmm. What does due process mean?
Well, the kind of odd thing about the doctrine that I'm talking about is it's got no process in it. Usually what it means is I can take away your liberty as long as you have a trial, for instance.
But right? What is the definition of due process?
The definition is it's the procedure, whether it be legal, like a trial, or legislative, to which you are entitled before your liberty is deprived. I guess that's the usual.
And that's
usual.
An entire category in law school.
It's a huge, you could teach a whole 3 years of classes about it. And then there's a
so
second.
So it's what you're entitled to
right.
under the Constitution as a plaintiff, as a defendant,
right.
as a citizen.
Right. And it's not a guarantee of absolute rights. I think the idea is as long as you get this trial or the process to which you're entitled, that we can, it's it allows for liberty to be revoked.
Excuse me, I told you he wasn't an idiot.
that was amazing.
Why did you think? Yeah, you said to me that you thought he was a lightweight.
He's doing this all without notes.
I know. It's incredible.
You know, I have a script that I memorized.
We need to undermine his confidence.
I'm starting to realize you're the lightweight, Feldman.
Oh, okay. Well, build me up and I'll build you up, okay?
Right. You know I can hear both of you, right?
Huh? Okay. What? Okay, so the doctrine of due process stalled the progressive movement in before
so they
the 30s?
Used it. They kind of expanded
He's
this idea.
He's really smart.
He
really knows what he's talking
about.
We're getting deep here. At some point, I'm going to just run out of things to say and give up and say, okay, I'm making it all up. They used it
to justify. There were laws to prevent child labor.
Well, in particular, the maximum hours legislation, for instance, is in this area of law that the court said New York can't protect workers' rights to, you know, work a maximum set of hours. Because, and now this is the twist of it, and this is why you could see why Roosevelt and others were critical of it. They said, because no, there is no process that can be due when it comes to major violations of liberty. So even though normally you can take away somebody's liberty with process, here you can't.
Because well, I don't know what do you mean by that. What do you mean?
Well, that's exactly what Roosevelt said. Like, I don't know what that means. It's a complicated doctrine. A lot of people think it makes no sense. The way that it's now understood is that even though the clause, if you read it very closely, says you can take away liberty with due process, there are some liberties that are so important that you can't take them away even with it.
By the way,
that was the idea.
Roosevelt read law and passed the bar, but never went to law school.
Yeah, and he, you know, I think here's the thing about Roosevelt. It's true. He did some stuff that seems unforgivable, like threatening to pack the court. Now, if Trump did that today, I think we'd be...
Explain what packing the court
is. He said, I'm going to add judges. I'm going to add so many judges that eventually we'll have so many that they'll be on my side, that the people who are on the court now will be irrelevant.
But the number is not written...
It isn't. No, it was. There was no formal constitutional violation that would have come from it. But it is something wrong with it. I think it's threatening another branch, basically, with your own power.
Would there be anything to having 100 Supreme Court justices?
You could do it. I'm reluctant to talk about it because I think this is the kind of thing that Trump would try once he finds out he can do it. And he actually tweeted during the election that when I think he was criticized by Justice Ginsburg, he said, I would like to swamp this court. That was the tweet. So he could do this. So talking, but he probably doesn't listen to the podcast, right?
No,
so
he doesn't. I don't think
he's an idiot, but he's not that big an idiot.
Well, I don't think he has the attention span. 4 hours, I think he can't. He probably couldn't do
that.
Yeah,
you're right.
So yeah, he could do it. And Roosevelt threatened to do it. And that's what ended, basically, the era that we're talking about, that they backed down.
Let me go back at the risk of it being heard by the wrong person. You're saying that with presidential fiat, essentially, he could add justices to the Supreme Court.
Well, they'd have to be confirmed by the Senate, but if they went along with it, and the Senate is pretty friendly to him, you know, despite these occasional challenges. But yeah, he could do it. It's a very scary thought.
And the Supreme Court could...
And Roosevelt threatened to do it and got his way and then didn't do it because he got his way. And, you know, he was doing it in the crisis of an emergency. It's a hard decision. There was the Great Depression that was basically what the question was he going to be able to solve that problem? But Trump could see that and kind of act in this, you know, extra constitutional way that isn't technically a violation and get everything he wants. And including, you know, and think of the things he wants to do, like take away free speech,
no,
the right to
free
criticize
speech,
him.
Travel ban would be a no-brainer then.
Oh, yeah. It'd be easy.
Yeah. All sorts of
I think it would get bad. Torture, I think, is another hobby horse of his. And... Mm-hmm.
So we're going into uncharted territory. The future is beyond our grasp. And there's no going back. People keep thinking, I don't know if you said it or somebody said, that the mistake we make as progressives is we want our country back. And you can't get your country back. We keep thinking if we get rid of Trump, well, it will be like Obama. It won't be. We're heading somewhere, and it's going to be informed by Trump, with or without him. Is it possible for a branch of government to reinvent itself, like the Supreme Court? Is it conceivable that some kind of insanity takes hold, and he does pack? He says, you know, there should be 100 wise, robed men who are voting on these... on the Constitution. Is that conceivable? That,
I mean, there's a political check, you know, which we talked about in the Senate. And so, but I think both of you kind of reacted like, really, they're going to stop them. And I share that. You know, there really is not much to stop it. There's the electorate. You know, we could stop them in the next election, hopefully. We could stop them in this, when it comes to the next election of the Senate. If the Senate flips Democratic, that would be a way to stop it.
I mean, it's interesting when you say
it's
stop
a real threat.
It.
I mean, this is real, I think. If he starts to increase his power, you know, he might get his way anyway. Gorsuch is his dream pick. I mean, this is a justice that would bring us back. He's as bad, maybe worse, than Clarence Thomas.
Why?
I mean, take, you know...
This is the only accomplishment of the Trump administration.
A serious accomplishment.
is putting Gorsuch into the Supreme Court.
Well, not to undercut it, but he's done more environmental damage with executive orders ever. So I always hear that. Oh, he hasn't done anything. Bullshit. He is destroying my planet.
Constitutionally.
Yes. Okay.
Fair enough. This is his only accomplishment. I guess the executive orders are, I guess they're constitutional as well, but.
Yeah. And the environment, there's not pushing. I mean, we pushed him back on the travel ban, but that's about the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
And the clean air and clean water regulations that he's, you know, they're called regulations. We want to get the regulations. They're protections. That's what they are.
And what's interesting about Gorsuch is that his mother, Ann Burford,
she was no day at the beach.
She was the first
EPA. Yeah,
she was the EPA administrator who refused to clean up the Superfund sites.
Awful.
And then what? Didn't she resign?
Yeah, she resigned in shame. I don't know if there's any shame in that family.
She was censored. She was the first cabinet official to be censored by the or it wasn't censored, but she was disciplined by Congress.
And what did she do?
Jimmy Carter set up these Superfund sites to clean up, like the Love Canal. There was all this money that was supposed to go towards cleaning up these disasters. And as an EPA administrator, she refused to take on the chemical lobbyists and use the money to clean up these sites. She was a Reagan appointee. And the Democrats controlled the House, and she was disciplined.
That's interesting.
And
I mean,
her son is now on the Supreme Court.
I mean, we talked about this on a previous broadcast about the impoundment cases. But, you know, one of the fundamental duties, maybe the most important of a president under the Constitution.
Impoundment is something that John Ehrlichman invented under the Nixon administration, where you couldn't get a line item veto. So Nixon was just going to impound the funds to balance the budget.
Yeah. And anyway, in both those cases, the impoundment case that you're talking about, and it sounds like in this EPA case, there is a constitutional duty that's being violated by the president or by, in this case, his cabinet member, EPA's cabinet level.
Right.
And that's the duty to take care that the laws be faithfully executed. You're not supposed to make the law, and you are supposed to carry out the laws that are on the books. And here's a Supreme Court justice whose mother is famous for basically violating the take care duty. And in the Affordable Care Act case, or what many people call Obamacare, we have a similar issue where the president is just refusing to implement the law. And to me, that's up there with major constitutional duties.
Let me ask Mark a question, because you're an outspoken environmentalist and you think the planet's under threat.
No question about it.
There are people who say, excuse me, I have post-nasal drip.
Well, you would barely know. You conceal it quite well. Somehow you make it sexy, David.
So an argument in defense of Scott Pruitt, who is the head of the EPA, and he's a tool of the Koch brothers. He's the Oklahoma attorney general who refused to enforce any environmental laws. The argument is that his constituents, the oil companies, are under assault, that the clock is ticking. Coal is over. Oil is over. And all Pruitt is doing is acting like a conservative and saying, slow down a little on this because we can't throw the fossil fuel industry out of business this quickly.
Yeah, I don't know about the acting like a conservative thing. I can't quite square that with the other stuff you said, but
well,
but
standing athwart history and slowing it down.
Okay.
Except Teddy Roosevelt was a conservationist.
Yeah, but whatever, a conservative liberal thing can be twisted to be whatever, but I think in the case of Scott Pruitt, as you, I think, quite well lay out.
He's really smart, right?
He's a real Renaissance man.
He's like his son.
Completely undercut.
And he's an Weatherman. I'm doing pretty good, right? Nobody knows I'm an idiot, right?
He's undercut what are minimal restrictions on the energy corporate powers. I mean, when we talk about, this is under threat, the coal industry is under, look, the coal industry is over.
Right.
And the coal industry is over because coal doesn't make economic sense anymore. And you can prop it up in all the ways that we prop up in this. And again, this is supposed conservatism, this free market that we pledge that we have in this country. We don't apply the free market to these energy companies. We subsidize them. We prop them up. Now we're doing everything but mining the coal for the coal companies. I mean, this is insane. We know it's the dirtiest fuel there is. And yet, even apart from that, it's not economically viable. So it's going out of business, even with all the propping up.
Right. So isn't a lot of this cosmetic? So, isn't Scott Pruitt and the EPA and
no,
all...
it's not cosmetic. And let me just quickly get to the energy, and then I'll tell you why. The other part of the energy question you asked, which was the oil. These oil companies still are vibrant parts of energy production. They are not in the same category that the coal companies were. There is plenty of shale oil. There is plenty of fracking going on. There is opportunity for getting oil in one form or another out of the ground for these companies for many, many, many decades to come, with regulations and restrictions and protections or not. So they don't need any help by removing these protections. And here's what happens when you remove the protections. And this is why it's not cosmetic. Because when you're talking about dumping toxins into water and air, you're talking about affecting people's ability to live well in this country and on this planet. So we're polluting this water for all time. There's no rolling it back. Some of these water sources have been polluted for all time. I'm talking the underground water sources. You know, when fracking is done, it's done with chemicals, it's done with water and horribly toxic chemicals. And when those chemicals leach into the water supply, it's gone forever,
We don't know what those chemicals are, right?
And that's something else. The minimal demands we put on explaining, we put the demands on the companies to explain what chemicals are in there. They're minimal. They don't have to explain all of the chemicals.
It's their secret sauce.
They just
they
have to explain
a
few.
Secret sauce.
Now they don't even have to list even the few chemicals that are used in the fracking process. To me, it's obscene.
And they've discovered during the Obama administration that fracking releases methane, which is
a greenhouse gas,
which we just found out is even worse than CO2.
The worst greenhouse gas, yeah.
And Trump reversed the methane laws, right?
Yes, I presume. In this moment, I can't remember.
The EPA now says you don't have to put a cap on the methane when you're fracking.
He rolled back so many things. It was hard for me almost to follow. And that's something else that they do. There's this kind of this fire hose of rolling stuff back, and you can't even catch it all. It's coming at you so fast.
Well, maybe because we're not paying attention to what's really important, and maybe Trump is a lot smarter than he lets on, because the show is a lot different than what's going on.
Well, I think that's their strategy, Bannon has said it, that you know, the more that we talk about race and they do these outrageous things, which are rightly condemned, and I think we need to pay attention to both, but we lose sight of these other things that they're doing, like destroying the environment forever.
Right. To me, it's these other things steal the headlines.
Yeah.
We pay attention, we're aware of the other, but the headlines are stolen by the race baiting and the tweeting, and now even the Manafort stuff and all of that. That is going to create so much smoke that we forget about the fire that is building on the environment.
Right. But I think the Constitution helps us here, too. I mean, you know, it's a lot of it is, well, it's all demoralizing to see that the federal government is basically abandoning the role that they should play. And one thing that we could try to do, and which is happening, is bring litigation of the kind that I said, demanding that the president take care that the laws be faithfully executed. And we do have environmental legislation on the books, and he's obligated to do that. But another thing, to me, maybe the most important thing that the Constitution itself allows is for the states to start to play a role and to fight back. So the fact that California is saying, you know what, if you're going to abandon the climate accord, we'll join it ourselves. And you know, that's something that traditionally conservatives have taken advantage of in the worst way. So fighting civil rights laws, for instance, is one of the traditional uses, awful uses of states' rights. But now I think the left and liberals have to get savvy, too, and to start to use the states to resist, really, in a variety of areas, like resisting ICE and the immigration policy. But also here, I think, resisting the environmental destruction. The states can band together, and the Constitution allows that. They are also sovereign under our system.
Do you think change happens at the grassroots level or from the top down? Obviously, both can happen. But what do you think is most effective for the Democratic Party?
I think both. You know, I once saw... now I'm blanking on his name. The governor
Tom
of
Stopper.
New York. The governor of New York.
Tom
Stopper.
You're just starting somewhere. You know.
Who's the governor of now? I just sometimes
the governor of New York
who resigned in the prostitution scandal.
Oh, Spitzer.
Spitzer.
Or yeah. I call him Spritzer.
Not too long. This was a public event, so I think it's fine to talk about the. I know it's fine to talk about. He was asked that question not long after he resigned. They invited him to give a talk on ethics at Harvard University, and I was in the audience. And you might think, well, that's a sort of bizarre thing for this guy to do. But the idea was
very ethical. He was the attorney general.
He also was prosecuting, you know, all of this financial shenanigans.
That was a hit
in a way that nobody else was.
That was a Wall Street hit.
Yeah. So that was one topic of discussion. But another was this sort of how do you, you know, what is it? Is it grassroots? Is it elite? And he was taking the side that it was elite, that basically, you know, in this country, it's a few very powerful people who are making decisions, and you better ensure that there are good people at that top level. And I think that is true, but I also think you need the election of those
people. You need
people.
AstroTurf. Yeah. That's what the Republicans have figured out.
Yeah, you need both, basically.
You need to make it look like it's coming from the ground up. Mm. That's
good. I like the AstroTurf.
Well, I didn't make that up. That's an actual term.
That's what they use.
They call it that?
Yeah, Dick Army.
Mm-hmm. Is that right? I'm not familiar with it.
The Koch brothers.
Yeah, sure. I know Dick Army. Yeah.
Yeah.
He used that phrase.
By the way, Dick Army was my nickname.
Well, maybe I don't know Dick Army.
When I did porn. No, it was Dick Luger. I'm sorry. But.
Wasn't
sorry.
You didn't tell me there'd be jokes.
Yeah. That wasn't a joke. That was an act of desperation. Yeah, the people behind the Tea Party was invented, and they call that AstroTurf. It was all funded by the Koch brothers. But
it also was real. I mean, that's the thing. It worked because there are actual people who self-identify. And yes, it was created, but it also has an effect because there are actual people on the ground. And that's what the Democrats need to be good at. Yes, having leaders who are going to be in the room, and also people making phone calls and going out and petitioning and arguing. And
I feel as though the Democrats are frankly, as a party, too wedded to the mainstream Democrat institution. We know that based on emails and discussions that we've become privy to. They don't, it seems they're ripe for a third party or a splinter party or the party within the party, a Tea Party movement within the Democratic Party. Call it the progressives, call it whatever. But I mean, that mainstream Democrats, I think, are going to be let down election after election because they're just feeling way too right of center in a lot of things.
Well, that's what I wanted to talk about. I sent some articles out to discuss this. Yeah, one of the things, I sent a series of articles about the breakdown of all our institutions and our ability to find out what the truth is. So when you talk about breaking down the Democratic Party, don't we need to build up our institutions? Let me just give you an example. The New York Times is back. That's a good thing. Their operating profit for the quarter increased to $33 million from $9 million last year. They added about 100,000 new digital subscribers. Mm. The New York Times is coming back. That's a good thing that the New York Times is coming back. We need institutions. Here's another story from the New York Times about academic journals. Everybody has to publish. Did you see that article? Yeah. There's something like 10,000 new academic journals because professors have to publish.
In order to get tenure.
In order to get tenure, in order to get jobs. And so now what's happening is the same way I can self-publish my manifesto on Amazon, anybody can publish any study. And it has this veneer of a scientific name, and then it gets cited by Breitbart, and they're off to the races on lies, where they just cloud the situation to the point where Robert Mueller now is being accused of being partisan. They just keep working the refs, and every institution now is suspect, which is exactly what Trump is about. He doesn't stand for anything other than being a wrecking ball. He just wants to destroy everything, and we no longer know what the truth is.
But here's why that's effective, just in general, because the three of us won't sit here and say, well, we shouldn't question the institutions. I mean, that's, I think, at our essence, even just us three, and I believe that probably most listening believe you should question the institutions, even the New York Times, which we are glad
is
doing well.
But you're saying, like, adding a third. I believe in a third party and a fourth party, and I believe in a parliamentary system. I don't think this, don't let Corey hear me say this, but I don't think the Constitution can deal with with me. I'm just too wild. That being said, I think you have to build up the institutions, work within these institutions, and make them thrive.
Okay, work within them, but questioning them, I think, is important. So what I'm saying is there are degrees of this, as you suggested, this sort of wrecking ball of Donald Trump. There are degrees below it that actually make sense. You should question if it's a fact-based question. But this idea somehow that, you know, just because an institution is working against you or is coming up, I mean, in Trump's case, as usual, it seems so clunky and obvious. There's not even a veneer of logic across any of
his stuff. It's George W. Bush. It's a Republican school of thought. If I don't understand it, destroy it. Just break it down. There is something good does come from destruction, Germany and Japan. I mean, there are people, you know, but
I mean, their assault to me is on truth and reason and science. I mean, this is all part of a package, depending on, doesn't matter what the area, that's the common theme. And that's what's so scary about it. I think it's great to challenge institutions and challenge power, but you should do it with reason and with science.
Exactly.
And with facts. And what they're doing is really assaulting the whole mechanism in democracy that allows us as people who are not in power to have a voice and to say something and to challenge. And what they want is to control truth and to shape things in a way. Somebody told, I can't remember who said it, but I saw somewhere, somebody said that if you've been watching Fox News over the last 3 days, you'd think that Hillary Clinton is on the verge of being indicted, that's the huge news. I mean, that seems absurd and funny, but there are people in America that believe that because they just have no regard for honesty.
There's more propaganda. We're awash in propaganda.
Exactly.
And now this sort of news where you shop for the news that you want. News essentially to reinforce the position that you already have. You can find it, and there's no greater example of that. Maybe I was going to say than Fox News. Maybe Breitbart's a greater example of it. Yeah. But I think it can be packaged now in a way that his, in this case, Donald Trump's grassroots supporters, the true believers, they're in that cult of personality.
Yeah.
They don't have to do any complicated arithmetic facts. They can just
listen to authority. Fits in. There are people who have kind of dispositions towards authoritarian personalities where they don't want to do the hard stuff of democracy, of sitting around and reasoning and arguing. They want to listen to somebody tell them what the answer is. And that's what he provides. But that is, to me, the biggest threat of what's going on here, because that is really a challenge to the fundamental idea of democracy.
Define the word discovery, because in America, discovery is different than it is in Europe. And do the way our trials take place in America influence the way we get the news? Because
you mean criminal trials?
Yeah, and discovery. I don't. You know,
is this going to come back to your divorce?
No.
That's too bad because I want to hear about that.
A laugh from the producer. That's pretty good. Now I'm happy. We never have a live audience.
Did you know that I got a divorce? Did I ever tell you that?
I've heard. That you needed advice, but I'm glad that we're through it now. I haven't heard you mention it in weeks, actually.
During the divorce, did David call you for legal advice, even though that's not
on the show? Repeatedly.
On the show?
In fact, this would be the point where he would start to ask if I had any opinion about it.
Yeah, because I noticed during his divorce, he was like, if you listen to his podcast, it was almost exclusively lawyers every week. He was talking. I'm thinking, there's got to be something on here. He wants legal advice without paying for it.
Did you ever think I would get, I've known you for since 1982. Did you ever think I would be the one who got a divorce?
No, I mean, actually, once you're 23 years in or whatever, I got to think after that, you're into the clear.
But we were like a magic couple, weren't we?
Yeah, I really would. I mean,
when you were sleeping with my wife, didn't she tell you how much she loved me? Right?
I have to, but you.
Okay, so discovery. It seems to me that
that was a good aside.
that lawyers run journalism. If you look at Ronan Farrow, he's doing great reporting.
Yeah, very important.
He's the guy who reported on Harvey Weinstein.
He broke, a lot of that.
Yale Law School, New York Bar. I mean, you can't do that kind of reporting without a serious law degree. So
I don't know about that.
Or I think, also philosophy is a – Chris Hayes was a philosophy student at Brown, and – the way that we do philosophy at Brown is very lawyerly-like. It stresses argument and reasoning. So I think you could get it other places.
Okay. Investigative reporting, though. I would assume that the lawyers run the New York Times. I don't think – I would assume when you start rolling up your sleeves and digging into Bill O'Reilly's background, the way they did over at the New York Times and Harvey Weinstein at the New York Times, the reporters are either lawyers or they're on the phone with lawyers all day.
I mean, Glenn, there are good examples, like Glenn Greenwald is an attorney, and it's not an accident, I think, that he's got those skills.
So discovery in a trial is producing all the evidence. Mm-hmm. And then fighting over what is true in front of a jury and a judge, right?
Yeah.
And the idea behind Fox News and Breitbart is kind of like the American trial system that we have, where you just put everything out there.
If you watch both, I mean, the system, it's a good analogy, but it rests on the idea of adversaries.
That's all I need. You said good analogy.
but you're
people
exactly
don't
right.
watch, you know, of people who just watch Fox.
Right.
They don't see the system as a whole. And I don't think it's functioning. Facebook is, breaking down what you see. Bahara in the event.
But do you get to the truth? Because in Europe, they have the inquisitorial discovery where it's the judge who asks for the evidence, right?
Depending on the country, there are some European countries, right, that have a more less jury focused, not an adversarial method, a kind of more
inquisitorial. And it's kind of the judge who's saying, I want to see this. I want to see that.
Right.
And he's kind of guiding.
More authority based, basically.
Who's what's better?
Mm-hmm. But David, there's no part of the consumption of information in America that is in any way like the judicial system. I think it's a tortured analogy. I'm
sorry.
Well,
I think the BBC.
I was being too nice, huh?
Yeah. No, I mean, I think you appropriately said, yes, if you take this all in. David's right. If you were to take this all in, it would mirror the process of discovery. Right. But
ideally.
The fact is people aren't.
But the BBC, there are ways to get to the truth in a way that's different than everybody throwing evidence against
the
wall to see if it sticks.
But in the inquisitorial method, too, it's deliberative. You know, the judge has got lawyers there. They're not arguing with one another in the same way. They're being asked questions, and the judge is sort of seeking answers from them. But the point is that the information flow is open and that there's a lot of it. And I think that's the breakdown in the culture now, that we just have the silo effect where you're not forced to see other things. I think I should say on the left, it's important, too. I think if you looked at a lot of Facebook feeds, maybe including mine, you'd think that the president is on the verge of being removed by the 25th Amendment. Now, I think that should happen, but that's one of those areas where I think, you know, that's wishful thinking. That Betsy DeVos and Ben Carson are not on the verge of removing the president through this maneuver.
They can't count as high as 25.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny. I was watching Laura Ingraham, who's the new voice on Fox News, okay? So she's on Fox News Channel. She took the place of O'Reilly, I think, taking a spot or anywhere, somewhere in that primetime lineup. And she was talking with Charlie Rose, which is not on Fox News Channel. And so it's that Charlie Rose type interview that you see on PBS, whatever. And she was articulate. She was thoughtful.
She's a lawyer.
She's a lawyer.
He's a lawyer.
I
may be a lawyer for all I know.
She was, of course, strongly in defense of the president and his policies. And she didn't sound like a crazy. She didn't sound like Fox and Friends, you know, lighter than air, just kind of reading a press release every morning. She didn't sound like a firebrand O'Reilly or Sean Hannity with his nose so far up the president's ass that you can't see his face anymore. And not like that. She sounded reasonable. And now to your point, I think we lose track because we get in the echo chamber of Twitter where you kind of think, oh my God, the president, I mean, it's a dumpster fire at the White House. How can he possibly survive unsinged? Then you see somebody like Laura Ingraham and you go, wow, because he's got people out there who have an agenda in their mind. And Trump is just the price they pay to get that agenda.
Yeah, that's what scares me, that a lot of these people are really smart and they're just using this sort of rhetoric and these maneuvers, this anti-reason reasoning to try to get what they want. The worst offender to me, I mean, really the worst, and you're not, especially you, are not going to believe this, but a person who is not only really smart, but in the book, I say this, that some of the best work on impeachment is done by
the Federalists.
Wait for it. And Ann Coulter. Her book on impeachment. And
really?
If you listen to her on impeachment.
Really?
During the Clinton administration. Now, I think she had reached the wrong conclusion. I could say why. But, you know, she's a lawyer. She has a degree from Michigan, University of Michigan Law School. I know a lot of people who were in classes with her, and by all accounts, she was really smart. And, you know.
Really?
And is really smart. And yet she plays this role that is, you know, really the worst caricature of what we're talking about, the anti-reason, the vile racism, and you know, and it's a disappointment because this is somebody who, there is no question in my mind that she could be a professor. She's a serious scholar.
What the stuff she wrote during the didn't she
That's her
work?
First book.
Did she work on the impeachment or did she?
She was campaigning for it, for impeaching Clinton, and she wrote a book on impeachment, which I've gone back and read, and I watched her early lectures, and you know what? It's pretty good.
Wow, really?
That's
yeah.
That's really great stuff.
Yeah. Wow.
I mean, I hope nobody uses this because it's in my book, but.
Wow.
It's true, yeah. I mean, it's reasoned, it's historically accurate. And, you know, she maneuvers it in the end to argue for the Clinton impeachment in a way that I think is wrong. But it is nothing like what you see her doing now. I mean, it's smart. Absolutely.
Can I ask a totally off? I'm sorry.
Let me just, before you do.
I'm sorry. And, you know, David just glared at me. Roast. That was really scary.
And David wrote this roast of her.
How dare you?
Well, we wrote the roast and we thought we destroyed her and Trump.
Yeah.
And you can't destroy them.
So did Obama, right? In
Locking
in that White House Correspondents' Dinner.
What's interesting about this is the University of Virginia was founded by Thomas Jefferson because they were sending off their best and their brightest to Harvard, and they were coming back to Virginia, the kids, and they were getting legal, you know, law degrees, and they were getting these crazy ideas about slavery. So Thomas Jefferson said, we have to create this university.
They're going to Princeton mostly, right? A lot of the elite. Had gone to Princeton, I know. And I don't know who else.
And they weren't happy with what they were coming home with. They were becoming abolitionists. So Jefferson said, we have to found this university. So the idea that you start law school, I hate to use the word tabula rasa, but that you come in there with a clean slate and that...
Why do you hate tabula rasa so much?
It's just pretentious.
I see, okay.
But the idea that you're a clean slate and now you're going to read law and come up with honest opinions, it's not true. You know, Gorsuch went to law school looking for precedent to justify what he heard growing up. And I can't help it. Sorry.
Want some water?
No, I like it because I like to annoy people. Right? Isn't that the problem? And
I don't know. I think it's complicated. Sometimes that's true that people are very ideological, can just use law as a weapon. I think there are people out there who come in with one set of views and wind up with another. I mean, my mentor in law school was Larry Lessig, and he's somebody who's talked about the fact that he grew up with pretty conservative views, and even I think in his early career, his views were on the originalist side of things, and over time, he's become a serious progressive. And so I don't know that it only works in one direction. What's really disturbing to me about her, about Ann Coulter, is that, you know, reading the book, talking to people, she clearly was sensible, intelligent, certainly conservative. And the way that she has, I mean, there's only one explanation, which is that she saw that this was a way to make money, and she saw it was a way to gain power, and she just abandoned reason and became this really disgusting, fascistic figure in American politics. And I don't know what that was, except for, selfishness.
Well, it's the Regnery Press, you know, the Mellon Scaifes. The people say, oh, you have a book? Well, we'll buy 10,000 copies of it, and it'll become a bestseller. That's why they don't go away.
And she had written this sort of sensible, again, I don't agree with the conclusion, but sensible impeachment book. And then she realized that, you know, I can do a lot better by just being nasty and abandoning reason. And, wow. Just sad.
I heard
it'll happen to all of us.
You had an anecdote, but you wanted to bring something up. But there was a story I heard when I was working for Bill Maher that after Politically Incorrect got canceled, they took him up to Fox News. This is before he went to work for HBO. And I've heard this secondhand, that he was shown the keys to the kingdom over at Fox News. They said, this can all be yours, you know, but you just have to start spouting this stuff. And, you know, Bill's a libertarian.
Right.
So he could have gone down
to Fox
News.
Not as long a drive as, like, from progressive land.
And he couldn't bring himself to do it, you know.
I was on a plane once, and I mean, I won't say the name because I don't have a way of verifying it, but the guy, I had gotten bumped up to first class, so all of a sudden I'm sort of, wow, this is really great, and who do you meet in first class? A guy who owns a lot of radio stations on the West Coast. And we just really hit it off, and we're talking, and started talking about this really famous, very conservative radio personality who was shopping the show very early on. And the person,
what year was this?
He was talking about 80s, that the show was being shopped in the 80s.
So it's Rush Limbaugh.
Allegedly. You can all guess.
I said.
And the person said, and again, I don't have a way of verifying it, but, you know, I could do it either way. And we'll see how this goes.
Right.
That's frightening because the most conservative.
You're saying this radio personality said, I can do this either way. I can be the firebrand conservative. Right. I could be the firebrand progressive.
And it was in particular in response to a station owner who said, what if it doesn't work? And he said, I could just do it the other way. Now that's a scary thought, you know, and you know, it did work, unfortunately, for all.
And just because you mentioned that world of radio, there is a much greater and more loyal audience for that right wing, obviously, than there is in the progressive side. I mean, just think about us progressives. I mean, I don't even want to include too big a group, because sometimes I use that label and it doesn't apply to it, so I'll just speak of myself. I'm not going to fall in line with anybody. I'm questioning, and I think there's a lot of questioning that goes on once you get to a more progressive liberal end of things. Liberals, we tend to take in information and evaluate, and we don't come down on the same side of every issue the same way, right?
I don't know about that, but go ahead.
Whereas I think the right tends to fall in line. It's like, we need to do this. And so when you get...
That's not true.
Oh, I think it's very
no,
much
they
true.
Have a schedule. There's a schedule to the way the Republicans, to the way the right think. They fight with one another during off-election years to create the illusion that there's an argument. And then as you get closer to election day, that's when they march in lockstep.
But that's what I'm talking about. They march in lockstep in the end. I don't care what happens before the parade starts. I don't give a shit where they're eating or where they're going or what they're doing or even what arguments they get into. Once the pie throwing is over, they wipe the pie off their face and they fall in line for the parade day.
But that pie throwing results in a different candidate on election day. It's a healthy...
Perhaps. I don't mean to diminish it too much. You're right. That process can bring forward a different person. But what I'm suggesting is they fall in line to support him. Look what happened in the last election. You could say a lot of progressives were bled off. Look at the last few elections. Progressives are either bled off to another candidate or they don't show up. They don't fall in line behind the Democratic candidate. And that's all I'm saying. And so to the radio thing, my point was simply that right-wing radio, or even just right-ish radio, but it tends to be pretty right, because I'm coming from that world too. Mm. Even in California, they have a loyal audience, a real vibrant, loyal audience.
But is there an audience for left-wing talk radio? You work over at KFI. I don't want to get you into any...
Yeah, and they have, I'm sure they think of themselves as sort of free thinkers, but there are a lot of right-wing I think a lot of right-wing positions being articulated in one point or another, and during the day.
We're never going back to the fairness doctrine.
Maybe
absolutely
we should.
Not.
Can we?
There was never litigation about it. It was removed by Reagan. I honestly think we need a serious discussion about it, and that goes right back to the core of what we were talking about. It was, you know, it's funny to see these shows. For me, I don't really remember it, so it's funny to hear about it, and you know, the Jane Curtin skit I've seen, of course, but how does it go again?
Jane, you ignorant slut.
Okay, I wasn't going to say that.
That was the best part of that sketch.
But, you know, there's some...
Literally slut-shaming in comedy.
The idea that you would be forced to talk to an adversary, I think, is something that we have to start to think about. And, you know, Cass Sunstein had a book called Republic and then Republic 2.0. This is a professor at Harvard. You should look at these books. He had one way to do it, which was that you would demand on the web that if you looked at one site, you had to look at another. Now, the web has changed so much, and we're beyond the web now with Facebook. So I don't know that specific proposal would work. But I think what he was trying to do is right, to say we've really got to start to think. It doesn't have to be through legislation or the same thing as the fairness doctrine, but to force people, I think, to at least have an opportunity or nudge them, as he puts it, to see other points of view. And I really worry about on the left and the right, but frankly, especially on the right, because it's fascistic on the right, the inability to encounter other views and to have the skill to deal with it.
Theoretically, an AM radio, talk radio station, if the fairness doctrine existed, you would not have a solid 50,000-watt wall of right-wing garbage all day. You would have to have your liberal. Mm-hmm. And this is conjecture, Mark, but if, say, a town like New York City had a left-wing progressive on a talk radio station because they had to have one, would it be better business? Would they do better business?
They might.
If you had an angry liberal screaming and spouting, get off my phone, and we need class warfare, and you're a fascist, and you're a racist, and doing the same theatrics as the right wing.
If the theatrics were done well, it's always going to be commercially viable. I mean, the key to these guys is not necessarily just the right wing part.
It's the hate.
I was mentioning that everybody falls in line. But it's also that there's a theater to this. It's in the cell, right? If you get on there and you're just opining about progressive liberal values, if you're not doing it in the right way, then if there's no theatricality, if there's no sell, it's like a teacher. You've got to communicate to your students.
Here's the problem with liberals, and it's Corey Brettschneider's fault.
I was going to say that maybe one idea.
We're so glad that we've got it. It's so lucky we got him here.
You've
got
to bring together a boring academic and the writer for Triumph the Insult Comic Dog. And that's an idea for a show that could sell. It's the professor and the comedian.
Here's the problem with liberals and progressives, Dr. Brettschneider.
Yes, sir. I'm ready.
I've been interviewing progressive candidates who are running for the House. And I interviewed, I'm not going to mention his name.
Why? I don't want, if you interviewed him.
Well, I'll tell you why. But it was virtuous what he did. So we were talking about ICE, and we were talking about the rights of undocumented immigrants, and we were going over it. And he's a lawyer. And I said to him, and he's a candidate for Congress, and I said, can ICE just kick open a door if you're an undocumented worker? And he got kind of caught up in the anger towards ICE. And he said, yeah, they unlike a regular citizen— they're not protected by, is it the Fourth Amendment or Sixth?
Yeah, Fourth is on search and seizure.
Search and seizure.
Yeah, I don't think that's right, by the way.
So, right. So hang on. So, yeah. But he was worked up and he was, you know, he's a
I mean, they might do it, but they can't.
Right.
Yeah.
So he misspoke.
Yeah.
And it went by me because the passion was there. Mm. He was speaking up for the children, you know? Mm. And a week later, he calls me. He said, I misspoke.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah.
And I didn't dignify his email. Like, what do you, he was correcting himself.
Right.
He said, they do need a warrant. I made a mistake. Well, how often do you hear a candidate
admit that?
Admit that.
Yeah.
I should mention his name.
That's good. That makes me like this person.
His name is Sam Jamal. He's 35. He's running for, I think it's the 39th district in California.
I think that's great.
It's fantastic.
I mean, to acknowledge mistake and we're all fallible. I misspeak all the time.
Yeah. And I said, I said, boy, what world are we living in where congressional
can't admit it. Yeah.
So when we talk about the theatrics of a left-wing talk show host, they can't do it because the progressives were...
Yeah, there's
we're worried we're going to make a mistake.
Right. And I have that. And, you know, it's funny. When I'm on the radio back there, I remember I was coming off there was the Dallas shooting. Remember when all the cops were shot in Dallas? Mm-hmm. It was military style. And I was very guarded about the way I was talking about it. I didn't want to jump to conclusions. I mean, I just would tell the story. I don't care that anybody knows, really. I suppose that the program director called me and she said it was just you're too tentative about the facts. And so we didn't have any facts.
Then. Right.
She said, yeah, but I'd rather you be wrong and strong than.
Wow.
And so I thought, wow, that's really.
Wrong and strong.
Yeah.
It's a good insight to what's happening.
But let me be fair to her. She's trying to make a point to me in general, which is. Don't worry about always having every I dotted and every T crossed. Go on, give the position. And she's also saying this, to be fair to her. I'm not worried about you. You're not going to go way off course with some BS. So just go ahead. Don't worry about, we don't know this, we don't know that. Because she said you get caught up in the tentative and you'll never, it's hard to listen to. You want somebody who's giving it to you. Just give me what I need to know. Give me the facts. Give me what I should believe. That's where you get to the other part. So when you jump into give me to what I should believe, then you've opened the door to real bad stuff.
I was stumbling. We have 5 minutes left. I was stumbling through YouTube, and I came across Walter Cronkite reporting the death of Lyndon Johnson, which is not a big story. It was 1973, and it was live during his newscast, and it was breathtaking to watch because. He was doing this. We hear that it may have been a heart attack. There's no authority there. Mm. A lot of uhs and ums.
It's being honest.
And he's the most trusted, supposedly the most trusted man in America. And it's we're hearing reports that he may have, two people have confirmed that he's now dead. Total... lack of polish.
Yeah.
I don't know. Were we better informed back then? Probably not. I think we're more informed now. I still think things are better now and we're freer now and less corrupt than we were back then. We just know how bad things are now. I think there's more transparency.
Yeah, but there's also more of a danger because you could have a life where you listen to Alex Jones and you listen to Ann Coulter and they're speaking with all that authority that you're talking about and they are telling lies. And, you know, in her case, lies about non-citizens. In his case, lies about everything.
Right. Can you get into, we have very little time, but you're dealing with young kids in some of the top schools in the world. You can't get into these top schools believing Alex Jones, believing Ann Coulter. You're not coming across students who...
No, I'm not. I mean, that's the thing. So I'm in a bubble, too. We have certainly a lot of conservative students, but no, they have, you know, just as often at Brown, frankly, they're better at reasoning because if they want to be listened to, they've learned over time that there's a presumption from many students and maybe some faculty against them, not all certainly. And the way they win people over is, you know, through reasoning. So when I look back at some of my best students, they definitely are often on the right.
And where do they get their, like, I go to the National Review. I can't bring myself to read the Weekly Standard because of Bill Kristol.
Although he's, I find myself agreeing with him. He's
reinvented himself. You know, people are using Trump to reinvent themselves.
He has a PhD in political theory, by the way, from Harvard.
Yeah. But where do you go if you want to hear sound right-wing reasoning?
I don't know. Reason Magazine is one. You know, I have to think. You know, I think so, it just depends on the writer often. So some of the stuff in the National Review I think is awful. Some is good. Sometimes First Things, which is a very conservative publication, but they can do good stuff. I have to think more.
Okay.
I see the stuff popping up all over the place. I mean, yeah, I see reasonable op-eds. I mean,
Wall Street Journal sometimes, not always.
That's a great point, yeah. Wall Street Journal. And again, I just think in general, we're awash in more conservative stuff, and it's showing up in what you might consider mainstream or liberal publications. I include the New York Times, for example. Then liberal stuff showing up in right wing publications. You'll see virtually none of that.
Okay, before we go, and by the way, this was fantastic. I could do this
all day. Pleasure.
This was a little different than what we usually do.
It's great.
We're going to get back.
Terrific.
We need to get back to reading cases, and but you've been it's my fault.
We do Tuesdays with Corey, which is often on a Friday,
which has
got a laugh from the producer. All right,
which is
because he usually listens to doesn't joke. He just has the show turned down in there.
Before we go, There was a terrorist attack this week in New York City. I was going to get my new eyeglasses, and I look up and I see on the TV 8 dead, terrorist attack, Allah Akbar, God is great. Is it my imagination or was it, I'm not trying to be glib here, another day in New York City yesterday?
Right. Yeah, you're saying it's amazing. You're saying it didn't have the ripple through the city that you...
Was it 9/11?
Or even what goes on in Paris. 8 people died. Why did it feel different? It seems to me if it happened in Paris or London on the bridge.
We were with our 10-year-old on 68th Street, which every year has this sort of amazing haunted house, and everybody was out with their kids.
Yeah. I know, and they closed a bunch of the city streets down for the parade yesterday and last night.
That was
by design. They didn't want, you know, the mayor came on, so we want everybody to go out and enjoy themselves. There was that whole thing.
But it was like a defiance. We're not going to let this.
But did it feel like, maybe I'm just such a narcissist and so caught up in my own misery, but did it feel like a terrorist attack yesterday? Or was it kind of, it just felt like, I said to the optometrist, what's that? He goes, that happened 10 blocks over. Like, another country.
Different name.
Oh, wow. Well,
were you shaken by it?
Yeah.
You were? Okay.
Yeah.
I'm dead inside.
And it was on the bike path where I, you know, we bike almost every weekend on that path. And so to see the pictures near Stuyvesant High School and that soccer field, I thought it was awful. But I was also happy to be out and not to sit inside cowering. And so,
but there were reactions from Washington that were along the lines of Donald Trump, the president, wants to revoke and undo the lottery system for immigrants in this country.
Yeah, the idea he'd use this like to just advance the travel ban or any of his crazy ideas.
Now, if it were a white guy who just opened fire and killed 8 people, don't know what the conversation would be.
I saw something on Twitter that he wants to undo immigration provision that has diversity in the title that was actually advancing the interests of white Europeans. He just saw the word
"don't get fooled
diversity"
by the label.
Is like helping Irish and English immigrants come to the country. Well, so that just tells you something about the level of intellect you have in the executive branch right now.
Brett Ratner, do you know him?
No, I don't. Never met him. I just at his house, actually, for Peter Bogdanovich's birthday, though. Just love dropping that stuff. It was really wild. It's a great house. I did meet him there, yeah. Why do I need to know him? What happened?
I have a theory, and we'll discuss this next week. I'm going to end on this. That guys like Harvey Weinstein and Brett Ratner, who allegedly is a rapist.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
He
didn't mention it when I just briefly met him.
That they didn't get to where they are in Hollywood in spite of they're being rapists. I think they got to where they are because they're rapists.
I think the fact that they're rapists has nothing to do with their success in Hollywood.
Well, I think we're going to, if this is successful, the outing of these men, and it won't be, but if we're going to be successful outing these rapists, then we can change the way we do business in America. There's the sex. Rape isn't sex; it's power.
It's violence.
We are a rape culture, and women are being raped, but it's part of the makeup of our corporate culture. That we rape each other metaphorically.
But the first one. But let's just talk just for a second. I know you have to leave, but the literal rape, which is a violent act, is taking place, and people are succeeding like Weinstein, if it's true about Ratner, then Ratner, in spite of the rape
it's because they're rapists.
You're using the word rape in a metaphorical way, and that is a disservice to the violence associated with the actual act of rape. It's an awful, awful thing.
I'm not, of course.
No, I know you're not saying it's not awful.
I don't know that? I'm a rapist. I know it's horrible.
But when you say rape, I think you're extending it now, because I agree with you. I think you're making the point about the subjugation of women throughout, the subjugation of certain workers throughout. The corporate overlay permits this. In fact, institutionalizes it. I agree with that.
Yeah. I'm not discounting the rape. Of course.
No, I know. I'm not saying you're discounting it.
Of course it's horrible.
But I'm saying when you do fold it all together,
it's part of a rape culture. Rape is the worst thing you can experience. But these guys succeed because that's the way they think, that they're obsessed with power and taking what they want.
I would agree with that.
But seriously, let's plug some books and gigs.
Transition. I will be every Friday, Caroline's.
Chico's Chuckle Hut
in the audience.
We're going to do a Tuesdays with Corey. I wanted to find. We have to wrap it up. I wanted to do a Tuesdays with Corey and Stan.
Sunday, the Comedy Cellar behind the pole that they always block my view with. If you're listening, Comedy Cellar.
When the State Speaks. And also, we have a Facebook page, Tuesdays with Corey.
We do. If you want to join it, you can just plug in Tuesdays with Corey on Facebook, or you could friend David, or if you're friends with him, just ask him or me, and we can add you.
Right. And you're on Twitter?
I'm on Twitter, at BrettschneiderC. You could read my work, CoreyBrettschneider.com, and look for my book, The Oath and the Office. Pretty soon it should be up on Amazon.
Thank you. It's an honor for you to know me,
it
Corey.
It is. Terrific. Thank you so much for letting me be here and be part of a comedy podcast. And By the way, please, next time I can tell you about my comedy ideas, but I've got a very good one that involves Steve Bannon in Biodome. It's a cartoon.
Well, I've
been working on it.
I've heard a couple of them. I've heard one of them before.
Because you're a real Hollywood producer, so this is like a big chance for me.
Mark Thompson.
Please join me on my podcast, The Edge, with Mark Thompson. You have to put in the With Mark Thompson part because there are a jillion shows called The Edge. You'll find it on iTunes. You'll find it on Stitcher. You'll find it on iHeartRadio.
And we can hear you on KFI.
KFI.
Watch you do the weather in L.A.?
I'm on the weather on Fox 11 there in L.A. occasionally. So, yeah, there are all these different ways to participate. I'm on Twitter at Mark T. Live, at Mark T. Live. And my Instagram is very popular. Not quite as controversial as the Twitter feed. It's Mark Thompson TV, at Mark Thompson TV. Those are all the ways. Thank you, David. Always fun to see you. Great to see you in your element here in New York. A lot of fun.
You're my favorite vegan.
Thank you, man.
He's a vegan. Yeah. Let's eat.
Thank you. All right.